Yesterday morning in Denver, Pat Burns was relieved of his duties as coach of the Toronto Maple Leafs.
And with that announcement, Pat Burns was gone, a victim of circumstance and high expectations. The team he coached into a contender simply could not contend with the two-month slump. And because of that, Fletcher had to fire him.
We have confidence that our players are a lot better than they've been playing recently. That's obvious. And we think they can get it back together. And that's why we made the change.
The change to Nick Beverley, whose inexperience puts the onus on the players to recapture their winning ways. He put the players through their paces at practice this morning, his first since he was a head coach in New Haven in 1985.
The bottom line is that one of the biggest things that has to change is the mindset. And we always say you can't just reach into the air and grab confidence and hand it to the players. It comes from within. So we're going to be accentuating the positive and doing everything we can to support them in that vein and make them feel good about themselves again and just get out there and play hard.
No one played harder than Mike Foligno. And to communicate the value of that, he's been added as yet another assistant.
One of my greatest attributes is to be able to speak to people, to be able to communicate with people. And I think that that's one of the first things I'm going to have to try to do to make sure that every player is understanding of what is expected of them and what are our expectations are as a coaching staff.
The expectation is Foligno's infectious nature will have a spillover effect on what appears to be a divided dressing room. Divided about Pat Burns and about how to handle losing.
I don't think there's a problem in the dressing room. I think guys are looking for excuses. Guys are looking the other way. I think every player in that dressing room has to take fault for the way we've played. And it starts from myself. You know, our line that's out there on a given night, all the way down to the fourth line.
In short, Burns took the blame, but isn't the only one to blame. He knew it, the players know it, and some even admit it.
I said, I'm number one on the list of why a man got fired. And that's not an easy pill to swallow.
You know, I think everyone felt like they did let Pat down in a way that, he's the guy that loses his job.
Well, it must be very tough for a guy to, you know, come in with 18 games left and try to turn this whole boat around. We've dug a very big hole for ourselves, and the best part is we're still in a playoff spot.
Make no mistake about it, Pat Burns may be gone, but the problems plaguing the players remain. Yet it remains to be seen if they have what it takes to prove to Cliff Fletcher that this latest move is the right one. Rob Sinclair for Sportsline.
I think Cliff was watching the whole situation. He could feel the strain on everybody, and especially on me, and I think it was something that he said that we sort of sat there and almost in tears, both of us, that when he did it. And I said, Cliff, I understand. It's not your fault. That's the way it has to be, you know. And he was a great man to work for. It was a lot of fun. It's a great organization. But right now, we're going nowhere.
I think he's the right man for the job at the right time.
Now we're talking. Now we're into it, yeah. Send him on, he said. Send him on the ice. Come on.
An intense Pat Burns spent four seasons as the Montreal Canadiens head coach, a trip to the Stanley Cup Finals, Coach of the Year honors, before surprising many and jumping over to Toronto.
We need a commitment from players. We need a commitment from 20 guys every night with blue and white jerseys on, and I think that's going to be my job.
It was early in training camp when the players received their first-hand look at their new boss and the Leafs' 22nd head coach in their history.
He's very demanding. He doesn't ask anything that you can't do, but he asks a lot.
Burns' coaching style went well with the type of team the Leafs had assembled. The club set records for wins and made a 32-point improvement from the previous year. The highlight for Burns came in his return to his former home when the Leafs knocked off the Canadiens. All setting up their first postseason spot since 1990.
Well, I had a bit of a conversation with my agent with Donnie Meehan, and Donnie called me last week, and I remember he said, geez, if you could beat Detroit, Pat, you could be mayor of Toronto. I said, well, that's funny, because when I signed, I said, back in May, you said all I had to do was make the playoffs and become mayor. Now I have to beat Detroit.
Scores! Scores!
Forget mayor, Burns was ready for premier after moving the Leafs into the division finals, where they met up with the Great One and the Kings. The on-ice action was almost as entertaining as what was going on between the benches.
Behind the Leaf bench, there's Burns telling Melrose, if you want to play that way, you're going to have to go through me too.
Except for maybe a non-call on a Wayne Gretzky high stick, Toronto would have been off to their first Stanley Cup final since last winning the Cup in 1967. In the offseason, Burns was voted Coach of the Year for a second time.
I think Pat Burns, the coaching staff, and all the players did a great job this year.
Year two, Burns and company built on what they had. The team recorded back-to-back 40-plus victories for the first time in history. The defensive style with key offensive players, and the Leafs machine was off and skating again. This year, the question wasn't if the team would make the playoffs, it was how long a run they would have.
We're hoping that with, you know, some solid work and some solid games and very few mistakes, we have a chance of going to the finals.
And McCowan was close, but for a second straight year, a trip to the conference finals was as far as the Leafs would get. This time, Vancouver knocked them off, a disappointing finish to another strong year. Pat Burns' third season behind the Leafs bench was a short one, all because of hockey's labor problems. The team again finished over 500, but it was a matter of survival, just to get into the playoffs to see if the Leafs had another great postseason in those sticks. After an opening round 2-0 series lead against Chicago, the Hawks fought back for a seven-game series win. And since Burns took over, it was their earliest playoff exit. It was Mario Lemieux's return to hockey and a forgettable start to Burns' fourth year. But it was a good fall and early 1996 for the Leafs. Then something happened, and the Leafs started falling. A streak that started in mid-January, swept through February, and was into March.